her care the cautionary tale of Avni, the murdered man-eater. The nation mourned the killing of a tigress last month. Avni, or T1, who roamed the Yavatmal forests in Maharashtra, was declared a man-eater by the Supreme Court, and the court ordered that she should be shot at sight. She was a mother tigress, the mother to two cubs who were 10 months old and who needed her. A lot of emotion was whipped up in social media by urban activists who tried their best to stop the killing of Avni. However, Avni was finally shot dead after evading hundreds of people who were after her, including drone cameras, Calvin Klein perfume, and, you know, the entire works. We are here to discuss the tale of Avni. We don't know whether we can call it a murder, but the common man wants to know what actually happened and how should a man-eater be treated. We will be talking to Mr. Sumit Sen, commentator, writer, and wildlife photographer, for his views on this issue.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's not discuss first the whether it was right or wrong to kill Avni. I have a big problem first with humanizing animals. Why do you want to call a wild animal, the earth, Avni? I mean, that's completely wrong. It is a wild animal. Let it be a wild animal. Don't make it sound like, you know, it's your pet dog. That's the first thing. The second thing is the word murder doesn't work here. Murder is for human beings. So putting away Avni is the right way, or putting away this tigress is the right way of, I think, addressing this question. Having settled those two issues, let's see if we can throw any light on why she was eliminated. This is a tigress who lived her life at the fringe of a forest, where she was in contact with humans and, more importantly, with livestock. Ever since the government decided, this current government decided that cow slaughter or cow, or anyway, removing cows is not on. Farmers are left with cattle that they don't know what to do with. Once a cow or a bullock loses its ability to contribute to your household, it is a cost. So what happens is such costly animals are no longer fed. They are pushed into forests. What is prey for a tiger, since we are discussing tigers? Prey for a tiger is anything that moves which is edible. Yeah. Includes humans. But it's far easier catching a tired old cow than to catch a fast running deer. So in the place that Avni lived in, we had cattle moving in, so she was constantly in touch with cattle and coming closer and closer to humans. This is the start of the problem. The bigger issue here is not why the tigress was eliminated, but of what are we doing with the population of tigers we have, and how are we trying to conserve these tigers in a landscape that we are constantly eroding away with our population growth. So it's good to know that we have 2,500 tigers, But it's very bad to know that we don't have forests that can hold anything more than what we have now. So I think that is the base of any discussion that we have. You must understand that we have taken forests away from our wildlife. We are sending in animals of which are household farm animals, which are food for them, close to them. And in this way, we are altering their behavior. Human deaths, as a function of that, can become very common. Avni is just a stray incident. So having said that, I think we can move on.
Our tiger population is growing, which is a happy thing. But with the growing numbers, do we have space for them? Because human-dominated landscapes are also growing.
So I think there are tiger experts. I'm not a tiger expert, but there are two things that you have to deal with here, which I just want to explain. The easy answer is if there is food, there can be tigers. But I think all tigers, all wild animals, have a concept of range. I even understand that tigers need range for their genetic balance.
Yeah.
So when you take away land from tigers, you are taking away range. So even if you push in n number of food animals, they'll still need to fight over territory, have their own territory, they'll still need movement. So I think we need more science in understanding how many tigers India can hold without raising this man-animal conflict to a level where conservation becomes a problem. Because you must understand that eliminating this tigress had all to do with conservation and actually protecting tigers in India. Social media is full of people who sit in armchairs and never actually walked in a forest where a tiger is. At the best, they have seen a tiger from the sanctuary of a jeep.
So that's
how many people have actually walked the forest where a tiger is also there on the prowl. Not even a man-eating tiger. Forget the man-eating tiger. That's the worst nightmare. A normal tiger. How many of the people who are talking about protecting Avni has ever walked the forest?
So that's where this urban-rural divide on conservation comes in. Do you think that this activism on conservation is gaining a very cosmopolitan overtone?
No, this is all, I think, all this focus is, it's very, very good that people want to protect wildlife, do things. You know, the other day I was reading an article which said that some movie star who got married had been questioned by PETA that, you know, why was a horse used for her wedding? Because it's cruel to the animal. The very fact that the horse only exists and had been bred to do something like that, of course, escapes the attention. You know, people say, don't kill chicken, don't kill this. All of these things are not needed, wouldn't happen if they are not needed. I mean, you wouldn't breed chicken if no one ate them. So this question doesn't, but what I want to say is it's very good that there is this great thing about caring, but you know, I'd love these people to actually show care for things that matter. Why can't the people of India start talking about conserving the great Indian bustard, an iconic bird of India, of which there is only 90 left? All these tiger savers would have actually, if they pulled together and, you know, tried to save this bustard by encouraging the government of Rajasthan to have power lines going through the ground instead of, you know, being running through, where the birds get entangled and get electrocuted. We lost two birds in the last 6 months on power line. 92 out of 90 is like, you know, what is the significance of an Avni compared to those two losses? But is there anyone writing about it? No. All this conservation, armchair conservation, is good if it actually yields results. And people in India should focus their attention on such things that where they can actually, you know, encourage governments or people in power to do things which are good for wildlife.
We have seen that there's a clear dichotomy between animal rights and conservation. While animal rights deals with the individual, like with the right of an individual animal, conservation looks at saving the species. So in that scenario, was shooting Avni the right thing to do?
Absolutely. Shooting Avni meant that the people in that region who live with tigers would not start a campaign of poisoning all tigers in that area. It's very easy to poison tigers. One, if you did not remove Avni, you would have actually found all tigers in that area dead. You know, this is like very ridiculous. While about the time when Avni died, or this tigress died, there was another tiger who was killed by a bulldozer in, what's that, Vikram, what's that sanctuary in... No. UP sanctuary, the Dudhwa. It was a, and it had killed one human being, and the villagers managed to, the next day, find it in the field, and they ran a bulldozer over it and killed it. Does anyone know about this? No one knows about it. You make an icon out of an animal, and then you know you create a furor. But really, if you live in the where a tiger exists, and if that tiger is a man-eater, then you don't know what fear is. You really don't know what fear is. I mean, and your whole life is just destroyed. And the thing is that, you know, we are a democracy, but we in this democracy of this tiger, we are not measuring the votes in the right way. The right way is to, if the people of Yavatmal were on Twitter, they would have drowned the people who are sitting on armchairs and writing about saving Avni. But they're not on Twitter, so it's an unequal world. You're not getting to hear their voice. So, you know, but saving, removing Avni was very, very important from a long-term conservation view for tigers.
The national,
because villagers buy-in is a must in all areas that you are, because it's so easy for them to, they're living every day with these animals, and the forest department can do just so much.
The National Tiger Conservation Authority's standard operating procedures say that it is human interference which creates man-animal conflict and also creates man-eaters. So how fair is it to victimize an animal when we are pushing into their landscape continuously?
Not fair at all. But, I mean, if a flip side argument can be that we are successfully protecting the tigers in areas where the forests have been removed. So, you know, it's an effect of the success of protection.
Yeah, and now we come to something that's very tragic, which is the way Avni was put down.
Excuse me.
A hunter was called in, all the rules of procedure were flouted. The rules clearly state that the chief wildlife warden has to first lay down in writing why the tiger has to be shot, and then also clearly says that there has to be a team to put down the animal along with a veterinarian. But as events occurred, there was no veterinary doctor in the team, and it was just on the order of a minister that the tiger was put down by the hunter. How do we deal with this? How do we look at this?
Look, I mean, I am in no position to talk about who has the authority to, there is the law of the land comes first. So anyone who flouts the law can face the consequences of flouting such laws. But I kind of think that if I sort of sit back and look at how a tigress like her could be eliminated, I think it's fairly impossible to think that you'll have a team of 20 people moving around in the forest looking for this tigress, who had by then become so smart that it took someone like a Corbett to track her down and find her. So all this veterinary search and all, nothing would have happened, the killings would have gone on. Now, this politician obviously has a stake in the area from which the tiger operated. This politician's stakeholders demanded the removal of the tiger. His word was accepted. But it brings us to another thing about this, another question which you have not raised, but which is an issue in India, is of trophy hunting. You see, wildlife hunting in India, large game hunting, all wildlife hunting in India is banned, but there are a lot of trophy hunters who still have these glint in their eye when they think that they can actually pull down a tiger or an elephant. I must give you this story, which I think Vikram shared with me, others also shared with me in the past, that there used to be, we are a country full of very unethical people, so often what happens on the ground is not what was necessary, but what that person wanted. So to give you an example, while tigers kill human beings, elephants also kill a lot of human beings. And usually these elephants are tuskers, elephants with tusks. So and I come from West Bengal where such tuskers are common. So there used to be a law in the government had a rule which said that once a tusker is declared a rogue, it could be killed. And the hunter would then be assigned the job. So sometimes we have male tuskers without tusks. So what happens is the interesting thing was that the guy who killed the elephant or hunted down the elephant was usually awarded one tusk of the tusker that he killed. So if this guy was assigned a makna, as we call the tuskless elephant, he would go and injure a tusker while trying to kill the makna. He'd kill the makna. In the meantime, this injured tusker would develop into a rogue and he would be assigned the job of killing the tusker so that he got the tusk. This is the ethics. These are documented. These are the ethics of wildlife hunters. So we can't say whether the man wanted to pull a trigger to get a trophy or he could have saved the tiger by using a dart.
Another issue that that has come up is the issue of reintroduction of tigers in an extinct landscape, like it happened recently in Satkosia in Orissa. A male tiger was brought in from Kanha, and a female tigress, Sundari, was brought in from Bandhavgarh. The male tiger, of course, fell prey to poachers, and Sundari was eliminated because she was supposed to have killed a woman in that landscape. So what are the management systems that are required to be in place if you have to think of reintroducing any apex species or tigers into an extinct landscape?
There are wildlife experts who should answer this question. I'm not. I'm just saying that, you know, there have been some very successful reintroductions. Panna is a great example. Sariska is a good example. But my only view on this, based on no science, but just my own observation, is the forest that the tiger came from, and the forest that they were sent to in such cases were in a way similar. Satkosi is a completely different forest, and for a tiger to adapt to that landscape coming from Bandhavgarh.
And there was no prey base. There was absolutely no prey base.
That I do not know. If there is no prey base, then they should not introduce tigers.
Yeah.
But I think that that work possibly was not done. That, you know, you possibly needed a tiger from an area, maybe from a forest in Orissa, if Orissa had a forest where the tiger would have been more at home in that hilly landscape. So I can't really answer that question. But they must try. If there is a lack of prey base, then that has to be addressed first.
Absolutely, because like they say that, I mean, since Sundari did not find anything to eat, so she attacked the woman who had strayed into, you know, that landscape. I mean, that is what...
Yeah, I'm just saying that, you know, it's also possible that the sort of prey that exists in that forest is not the sort of prey that she was used to hunting in the forest that she
been
removed from.
Mm-hmm. Right. We, like about 2-3 years back, there was this issue of Usta that Ranthambore. He was also a man-eater, and he was caught and taken to a protected area where he still survives. Could that not have happened with Avni? Was it that necessary to put her down?
You know, it's a risk that no one is willing to take. What if, let us say that, you know, you stay in a village in near Bandhavgarh, and somebody comes and says, okay, this tigress used to be a man-eater in Yavatmal, but in Bandhavgarh she will be perfectly all right, and we are releasing her here. And then she comes and preys on your people. Who is taking that risk? I'm just asking you, who? I mean, can you really take that risk? And first of all, no one really knows why she turned into a man-eater. So usually, you know, if you have read too many of Corbett's books, you will find that either they had, you know, some weakness, or their mother was a man-eater, or something like that. There is usually some logic that not all of Corbett's stories are true, but even then he understood tigers better than a lot of other people. There used to be some story about lameness, blindness, but this tigress seems like hale and hearty.
Yes.
And, you know.
And out of 13
so
kills...
So it's even more dangerous.
Yeah. But out of 13 kills, it is said that at some places she hadn't eaten the victim fully. She had just attacked it and maybe eaten a little bit of it, and like which normally man-eaters don't
do. I mean, I have this theory, and I don't know if everyone agrees with this theory, but if tiger... See, the reason why I can walk a forest or you can walk a forest with tigers in it is because tigers have learned over generations that man is not a natural, food for them, not natural food for them, and it's best avoided humans. And that is called tiger's fear of humans. This learning is passed on from generation to generation. Science tells me that some 8 or 9 generations that such learning remains in wild animals. So when a tiger, for whatever reason, tiger, leopard, or any large carnivore, for whatever reason, loses that fear, then you are just like, you're possibly a very bad substitute for a deer. Right? You don't have enough fat on you. Don't have enough flesh on you. You possibly are quite bad to eat. But, you know, I mean, you're prey. You're just dressed.
Yeah, but it's normally believed that that a tiger wouldn't attack unless it's provoked. So, is it...
I mean, like I said, when a tiger loses its fear of human beings, it'll look. It doesn't understand that, I've lost fear. There's food walking.
We now come to the very delicate point of politics and conservation. Beginning with naming of tigers in wild areas, like you said, that they should not be named, or describing them as straying into human-dominated landscapes. Everything has been politicized, and it now looks like a game that's being played at the expense of these animals. What would you say to that?
No, I mean, when you have so many humans and so little forest left, it will become a game. I read somewhere, I'm not sure, but I read somewhere that where this tigress used to operate, We've just recently given over hundreds of acres of wooded landscape to Reliance Industries to build another factory. So, you know, such progress is the easiest thing to achieve. I mean, I sometimes joke about it that, you know, the right government will one day say, what is this Taj Mahal worth? Let's sell it. We can do some other things with the money. The forests are like that. It doesn't cost us to sell forest, and we can get some revenues to, to take the next step forward in our journey to be powerful people. I mean, we have this big problem. It's there in the corporate world also. It's there in politics also. Of, I will achieve at any cost, and let the next man come and clean up. So, as far as this is concerned, I don't think there's any answer to this, other than the fact that, we still, as a country, have a very, very proud record of dealing with our wildlife. I think we have, despite the fact that we have so much human pressure, the fact that we have coexisted with wildlife across large parts of India, is a tribute to our the way Indians look at wildlife. It's our culture, it's our education, it's our heritage. We should be proud of that. So I think the squeeze is on, but it's thanks to people who sit in this room, sit elsewhere, that there is still hope for wildlife in India.
What would be your conservation paradigm for the future? Kill or care is the topic that we are discussing today. So what would you say would be an ideal conservation paradigm?
You know, I think we're making too much of an issue out of one tigress who was eliminated by and large. I mean, even today's newspaper says that a pride of lions attacked a fisherman at 2 o'clock in the night in a coastal town in Gujarat, killed him. So that's in the newspapers today, or I read it on my mobile phone. Now, are we making a hue and cry about it? We are not. So I think the fact is that, conservation support, we essentially talking about, you know, in this case, this issue has been blown out of proportion by armchair conservationists. Let us get back to armchair conservationists. It's my it's my hope that armchair conservationists can be pulled together by the right people in the right direction so that they contribute to our conservation in a more meaningful way. Like I said, the Great Indian Bustard requires conservation support of a scale which is much greater than any killing of a stray tigress can hold. If the same people who wants to, you know, save the tiger or save the horse from being ridden, devote their energy and attention to saving an iconic bird species which is now only found in India from extinction, then I think their voices will have value for tomorrow.
Does compassion have any place in conservation? When you talk of armchair conservationists, what they say is that they care. They care about the animal, and they also are worried about conservation.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the big mistakes in the world was this panda as a symbol of WWF. I mean, we are making teddy bears out of animals. It is not the way that you should deal with conservation. You possibly should have had a vulture as a symbol of conservation, and then people would wake up and say that that is real conservation, not teddy bearizing. We like all this. We use mobile phones to make funny faces with rabbit ears and all that. You know, in the real world of conservation, such things don't work. There, your hard grit and your determination, walking the forest is what gives you the right to be a conservationist. Switching off the air conditioner doesn't give you the right to be a conservationist.
What about Avni's cubs, the two children that she left behind, only 10 months old? What would be their future? Are we going to think about that?
No, not at all. I mean, it's sad. It's the cost of conservation success, tiger conservation success.
Anything else? Then we'll open the house to questions.
Thank you for those wonderful words. We'd be open to take questions from the audience. Yes, sir, please.
Don't you think that each of the killings that we're talking, Avni, T1, the leopard killing, should be each case, or the Satkochia killing, should be taken as a sui generis case, as a unique cases in these places, and handled separately? I mean, what happened to Avni could have been avoided by understanding the problem. And I don't think any effort was made. This is completely shady what went on. You know, there were politicians involved, there were industrialists involved, they wanted it to be free of this thing. But the Satkochia thing was a disaster for a different reason, because nobody went into studying it before releasing this unfortunate pair there. The Ustad case was a completely different, I was involved in that, and she had killed 14 people, but we managed to tranquilize her and get her out of harm's way. So I think, don't you think that the Avni case was very, very badly handled? I'm not talking about armchair conservationists and all that. Because you could have done the same thing as you did with Ustad by tranquilizing and isolating her either in a zoo or somewhere else.
Yeah, first of all, I think the Avni case became even more important because it took so long. The more something like this keeps going on, the more voices come in, the more people get, get to express views. And the fact is that I think there is no one better than you on this, but I would say that each incident or each case of you know, shall we say, man-eating or elimination is different and should be, there can't be a textbook solution to this. And like you said, there are a lot of people who get involved in this who have nothing to do with wildlife or its conservation. And if there was a way of telling them after Avni's death that they should not have interfered or they were out of line, and if there is a way to penalize them, if the same people who said Avni should be saved actually start a Twitter campaign or whatever campaign saying that let the minister be answerable for his question, let the shooter be answerable, and if that can take this to the next level where an inquiry is actually conducted in an atmosphere which is free of, you know, our typical issues, and a verdict can be given about how this was done and how it shouldn't be done, then it would be a great learning, and this loss of this tigress would possibly be a gain for future efforts in managing such animals. So, but I suspect that, you know, we have this big problem of, like, I mean, this is my problem with India as such. You hear about somebody who had this gory murder case in the newspaper, and it goes on for 10 days, and then 20 days, and then 10 months, 12 months, 18 months down the road, no one ever follows up on anything. No one knows what happened to this story, right? There are so many such stories. We have, our media, our people have interest in the spectacular for a very little time. The follow-up energy is something that we sorely lack. No one ever questions, okay, that murder case, you had covered it, what happened? No media will go on there. It doesn't work that way in India. So I don't have much hopes about Twitterati getting together and questioning what happened after Avni's death.
But they are demanding justice, and they're saying that the hunter has to be penalized.
How big
punished.
Is that demand? It's very good if it happens.
Yes, of course. It is a very strong
but
demand.
Don't you agree that it's more than the hunter? It's the people who organize the hunt
Absolutely.
Should be held more responsible.
Absolutely. I think, like I said, I cannot sit in judgment sitting here not knowing the fact, but I think an inquiry is essential, especially where there are allegations that the law has not been followed. Any such case, somebody in authority should start an investigation and clear doubts. I mean, it's quite possible that everything was done as per procedure, we just don't know. But as long as there are doubts, there should be every effort to place what happened in the public forum.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, I mean, not related to specifically to this, but just your knowledge, like how much the government has allocated for wildlife in India, that's one, if you can. And second, in the last 5 or 10 years, what 2-3 steps government has taken for wildlife conservation, specific in your view, you know, just for our education, if you can say.
I can't really answer your first question on how much. If the allocations are based on what is given to Project Tiger and to various, and to the forest departments of the country. Allocations, I can talk about what allocations come to my state, which is West Bengal. Allocations rise essentially on a sort of indexed inflation measure. There is no extra allocation unless it is project specific, that, you know, let's say you are planting new mangroves in a fresh forest, and then for that there is funding. So that, I think there is no fresh initiative from the government as far as I know in large scale allocation. I'm sorry, what was your second question?
Any 3 steps government has taken specifically for conservation in the last 5 or 10 years, which you think is good, like what we have taken?
I think I'm not the best person, but there have been some maritime laws that have been passed, which I have read about in the last 5 years, which are to protect our, especially in the Lakshadweep area, to protect marine biodiversity. There have been various new sanctuaries which have been created or upgrade, or, you know, forests that have been upgraded to the status of a sanctuary. So while the area under protection has really not gone up because we don't really have any more area, the status of some of these areas has been changed, where there is a higher degree of protection now, that at least in paper that has been done. So plus the government has spent some, I really work on birds. The government is now active on flyways. Flyways are migration routes. They are actually working with the international teams on flyway management so that migratory birds are protected, and so those small things I know of, but Vikram can possibly throw more light.
Yes.
Let me just try and answer your question. It's the budget allocation to the Ministry of Forest and Environment is so minimal that for months go by that the forest staff doesn't get paid. They have the toughest of all job because they for months sometimes live in forests without connection, without food, where food has to be sent by elephants. They are taking on poachers who have the latest machinery, the latest guns, the latest vehicles, and the best they are armed with is a lathi. And on top of that, you don't. And it is, to go on with Sumit's point, about increasing or upgrading status of forests from, let us say, protected areas to sanctuaries, to wildlife sanctuaries. By the same token, the amount of denotification that is taking place of protected areas by saying, you know, every industry that is set up has to have an environmental clearance. A committee is set up by the government. And it's a mockery, because I have seen many of these environmental reports. And what you do is you go and you pay some retired guy and he will write whatever report you want. I have seen reports saying that out of the two species of tigers found in India, one is not found. I mean, something idiotic like that, because there are no two species of tigers. And under the current political dispensation, the word progress is going to come back and bite you. Witness all the things that you have interfered with nature in the last decades. You have dammed rivers. In the city of Bombay, you built Bandra Kurla. And that is why one night when it rained, 600 people lost their lives. Because you interfered with the natural flow of water. You concretized the city. So this obsession with progress is what is going to really haunt you for the rest. There are lots of sessions on water in this Lit Fest, today, tomorrow, day after. And you will have people, real experts, coming and saying that there is still hope if you get down to it. But I don't think the political will exists anymore.
Yes, sir, please.
Sir, I read the newspaper somewhere in the recent past, a few lions had died in Gir Forest. And one of the things that they had in mind was to relocate few lions to some other park in Madhya Pradesh or Rajasthan or somewhere. Has something been done on that?
No. No, he'll answer the question. No. It's almost like, there are few pandas left in China. Will China give a panda to India so that we can come and people can? It's something like that. I mean, it can actually become much worse. I'll tell you one example before Bikram steps in. I come from West Bengal. We have rhinos in West Bengal, one-horned rhinos in West Bengal. People think all the one-horned rhinos in India are from Assam. That's not true. So there are some in Dudhwa also, which have been translocated. But over the years, this genetic pool, we have about 100 rhinos. Assam has 1,500 rhinos. The genetic pool gets shrunk, and the Forest Department of West Bengal has for years been asking the Forest Department of Assam to trade a few rhinos. It's been refused. So your Gujarat question will be answered by Bikram, but my answer to your question was that.
No, what happens is that the Asiatic lion is only found in one area, which is the area of Sasan Gir in Gujarat. It's a healthy population now. In fact, it is too healthy, so there isn't enough forest. Therefore, you're seeing lions on the coast where this accident took place yesterday. But the big worry of the scientists is that if a disease takes place, like the foot and mouth, at one go, the entire population of the Asiatic lion, which is the only population extinct in the world, will disappear. So, wildlife department or the Ministry of Forests actually took it quite seriously. And some of us, I was a part of that committee, which went out to look at various places where the Asiatic lion could be relocated. And after many, many years of study, a place called Kunopalpur in Madhya Pradesh, near Shiopur district, was found, and which suited the locality, the locale, the prey base, everything was done. And it was declared a sanctuary, everything was done. And then the request went to the government of Gujarat that we want six lions and lionesses to translocate. Our prime minister was then the chief minister of Gujarat, and he made a statement saying that these are Gujarati lions, and under no circumstances will we part with them. So that was the end. We ultimately ended up in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court gave an order, this is about 4 years back, by which time the chief minister became the prime minister, that Gujarat should immediately transfer the lions to Puno Palpur, despite a Supreme Court verdict that fight has not moved an inch. In the meanwhile, in the last 3 months, mysteriously, 30 lions have died of some undisclosed disease. And, you know, I mean, it's more lions than what has been officially have died, but they're suppressing the news. And it could be very easy that this could become into a major problem. At the moment, it is
350,
you know,
I think.
It went down to 12. When Lord Curzon went to kill the last lion when he was viceroy, a Bombay newspaper picked up the story that there are only 12 lions left and the Curzon has come to kill it. And the Junagadh Nawab, Habib Khan, his name was.
Yeah.
So they got together and tried to save it. Now,
400?
It's between 400 and 450, which is far too much for the area. And they are now straying out and littering in fields on the coast. So that itself is a dangerous thing, that you have too many lions in an area so small. So the need to transfer, both because of the disease point of view, which is, as we speak, is taking place, as well as give them more space. And they're like, you know, if you go to Gir, which is such a beautiful forest, the lions are like kittens, like tame. The forest department with a stick is prodding. It's a wild animal, but it has been reduced to the status of a domestic pet, which is absolutely disgusting. It's your session, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Do we? Yeah.
In a country, like I said, where a state is unwilling to exchange, what hopes do you have of, getting Gujarat to part? It's an absurd country that we live in. From this Baikullah Zoo used to have some Asiatic lions.
Which are all mixed up, African, circus, all of that. And the Gujarat government went to Supreme Court and made a statement that if we will not give up, there is some lions in Patiala Zoo with the seeds from the circus, they're all mixture of all kinds of things. And Ulkota. So you take all the genetic. Anyway, it's not good news.
Thank you for that. Do we have any more questions from the audience? Okay, then as MC and a 90s kid, I have a question myself. I was wondering that as we progress in time and move from generation to generation, do you believe that the current generation is becoming less and more less sensitive to wildlife conservation than the previous generations?
It is actually absolutely the opposite. They're far more sensitive, except they're far less connect with reality. So nobody has to do this. All of us in our generation have actually visited wild forest. See, some of these people actually don't even know what a real cow looks like.
Yeah.
So the disconnect is huge, but the sense that they have to do something is far, far greater than any of us. So there is great hope. Somebody has to steer that hope.